Hello everyone and welcome to the chapter number 24 of Blender Master Course, part 2 of Procedural Shaders. In the previous chapter, that is chapter number 23, we discussed about the procedural shaders in complete detail and we even created a simple car paint shader. In this chapter, we'll go deeper into the procedural shaders by creating a sand shader in Blender and by understanding and revising all the procedural shaders that we have covered till now. So let's begin with it. Now I have opened up the default Blender file and my screen layout looks like this because we made it the default layout for understanding the shaders in the chapter number 21 of this course. We placed this plane, this UV sphere and some lighting in our scene and made it the default layout. So if you also want to set the scene in this way, you can check the link of the chapter number 21 and all the remaining chapters of this course from the pinned comment. But for now I'll go to the camera view by pressing 0 on the numpad and we'll be making a basic sand shader. So I'll delete this UV sphere by pressing X and we'll add a monkey or the Suzanne model. So press Shift plus A, go to mesh and select the monkey model. Let's move it upwards by pressing G and then Z and place it here. Let's apply the shade smooth by right click and selecting shade smooth. And to make it look perfect and realistic, we have to apply the subdivision surface modifier. Now one way to apply the subdivision modifier is to go to the modify properties, click on add modifier and in the generate, you will find the subdivision surface. But there's a shortcut available in Blender using which you can directly apply the subdivision surface modifier to your object. And that is to press Ctrl and then press any number. For example, if I press Ctrl plus 3, then it will apply the subdivision modifier. And here in the levels viewport, the number of subdivisions will be 3. Similarly, if I would have pressed Ctrl plus 2, then the levels viewport number would have been 2 instead of 3. So you can use this shortcut to apply the subdivision surface modifier directly to your object. And now to give it some material, we'll go to the shader editor, press on this new button, and here the default material is applied to the monkey object. Let's also go to the render view by clicking on this icon, and by default we have the Cycles render engine turned on. And you can check it from the render properties option here. Here we have the Cycles render engine. And to get a better view of this monkey object, I'll rotate it in the Z axis. So press R and then Z and let's rotate it like this and left click to finalize. Since right now we'll be making the sand shader, so I'll change the name of this material by clicking here and typing sand. And now the material is renamed to sand. Now to give it some texture, we'll go to the shader editor, press Shift plus A, go to texture, and we'll add the noise texture. Let's place it here. And to add an input node, press Shift plus A, go to input and select the texture coordinate. And I'll place it here. To connect them together, I'll use this object socket and connect it to the vector socket here. Now to connect this noise texture to the output, one way is to left click on the factor socket and then connect it. But a better way is to hold Ctrl plus Shift and then if I left click on the noise texture, it directly gets connected to the material output. But to use this shortcut, do ensure that the node wrangler add-on is turned on. We learned about the node wrangler add-on in the chapter number 21 of this course. Now if I look closely at the texture, it doesn't actually look like a sand texture. And to make some changes here, we'll go to the noise texture and let's try to change the scale option. Right now the scale is set at a very small value and we'll be increasing it to a very high number like 500. And now if I zoom in, you will see that it has this grain-like texture on it, which is similar to that of sand. In fact, you can add different layers of noise texture on this material. To do this, with this noise texture selected, press Shift plus D to create a duplicate. And let's place it here. I'll zoom out. This second noise texture will act as a second layer of texture for this material. And I'll be reducing the scale value for the second layer of texture so that it looks different from the first layer. So I'll go to the scale value and let us reduce it to a slightly lower number like 250. And let's also create one more layer of texture by again pressing Shift plus D and placing the noise texture here. Let's also change the scale of this texture and I think that we should keep it to somewhere around 100 or 150. Right now these two textures, that is the second layer and the third layer textures, won't be visible on the object's material. And that's because they are not connected to the material output. Currently only the first noise texture is connected to the material output. Now to connect all these textures together, select one of the textures, press Ctrl and Shift. And if I right click and drag like this, I can mix two textures together. So if I release, these two textures will now be connected to the mix node here, which will be connected to the material output. And now we have two layers of texture on our object, but we need to do some changes here. So I'll go to this option of mix and change it to multiply. And now we have some sort of rough grain-like texture. You can change the way it looks with the help of this factor value. So if I increase it, we get a much better texture. So I will keep it to a value of 1. And to connect the third layer of noise texture, left click on this node, press Ctrl and Shift, and with right mouse button click and dragging like this, I can connect both of them together to this mix node. Just like I changed this to multiply, I'll select this one also and change this option of mix to multiply. And we can also control the factor value here. So if I increase it, we'll get a texture like this. Let's zoom out to get a better view. But even right now, it does not have a realistic looking grainy texture. That's because the texture is not having any 3D effect on the object's material. And to get the 3D effect, we use the bump node. So I'll go to the shader editor, press Shift plus A, go to vector and select the bump. Let's place it here. I'll take this material output and place it here. Similarly, this principal BSDF, and I'll place it here. Now, to connect the bump node to the rest of the node system, we have to take this result socket of the multiply node and connect it to the height of the bump node. Then for the output of the bump node, take this normal socket and connect it to the normal of the principal BSDF. And to connect the principal BSDF with the material output, simply take this BSDF socket and connect it to the surface. And now we are having this white color on the object's material because of the base color of the principal BSDF, and this rough grainy texture is because of the combination of these noise textures in the shader editor. Now to look at the texture properly, I'll zoom in. And now we can see how this texture actually looks. Now it's not compulsory to set the factor value here at exact 1. You can change the value at any number like 0.5, but then you will get a different result here. You might not notice the exact changes, but if you are very precise about the texture quality and about the scale of the noise texture, then you can use this factor value from here. Right now this one looks good, so I've set the factor value of this multiply node to 0.5. Now one more thing to note here is that these three noise textures can also be used to give a detailed rough look to your object's material. And for this, I'll take this result socket and connect it to the roughness of the principal BSDF. And now the roughness will consider that value that it will get from these three noise textures. Also, it's not necessary to take only this multiply node for the roughness. You can select this one also. So if I take the result socket of this multiply node and connect it to the roughness, the other one will get disconnected and you will get a roughness based on the combination of these two noise textures. And now to give this sand some color, we'll go to the shader editor, press Shift plus A, go to color and select the mix color. I'll place it here, and also do remember to save your file so that you don't lose any work due to any error or some crash. And now moving to the color part, we have to choose two different colors that will combine together to make the sand color. So I searched on Google which two colors should I mix to make the sand color, and there I found that these are the two colors which we should combine to make the beach sand color. One is the cadmium yellow medium and the other one dioxazine purple. And so I searched for the HEX code of cadmium yellow medium on Google, and it showed me this code, which is FDD A0D. So we'll go to the color A, and in the HEX I'll enter FDD A0D and press enter to confirm. We can't see any changes here because this mix color node is not connected to the output right now. We'll do that stuff later, but for the color B, which is the dioxazine purple, the HEX code is this 5C3A93. So we'll go to the color B, and in the HEX, I'll enter 5C3A93 and press enter to confirm. Now to see the changes here, take this result socket and connect it to the base color of the principal BSDF. And now the color of this monkey object looks like the beach sand color. And don't worry if you're not seeing the same results of textures that are being shown here, because Blender takes some time to render these samples, and only after the completion of a particular number of samples you begin to see the texture properly. And if I change anything here, it restarts the sample count, and that's why the object texture looked different initially. Even if I zoom out, you will see here that the sample count will restart from 1 and slowly it will render, and it might take a few seconds or even 1 or 2 minutes based on the specifications of your PC. But right now the texture is clearly visible on the object's material. And also I think that we should change the lighting here. We have added two lights in our scene. This one is the white light and this one is the pink light. But I'll select this light, and to change its color, go to the object data properties here, which is the bulb icon in case of this lamp. Go to the color option and let's change it to white color. To make it look perfect white, you can go to the HSV option here, change this value to exact 1 and this one to exact 0. And now we have the perfect white light in our scene. Let's go back to the camera view by pressing 0 on the numpad, select this monkey model, and here we have all the nodes in the shader editor. And now we'll be moving to the next topic of this chapter, which is understanding the sky texture in Blender. For this, I'll first zoom out, and we have to delete this plain background from the scene. So I'll select this, press X to delete it, and we'll be adding a new plane. So press Shift plus A, go to mesh and select the plane. Tap into the edit mode and press S to scale it up. Let's scale it up even more, and this much should work fine. So I'll left click to finalize this. And now we have this monkey model with the sand shader and a simple plane in our scene. Let's come out of the edit mode by pressing the tab key. Now the sky texture is basically used to add a procedural sky texture in your scene. And the special thing about this texture is that it is not applied to any object. Instead, it is applied to the environment around the scene. As a result, I'll go to the shader editor And to add the sky texture here, first we need to click on this option and change the shader type from object to world. So I'll change it to world, and here you have a background node which controls the color and its strength which you see around your 3D viewport. Now to add the sky texture, press shift plus A, go to texture and select this sky texture. Let's place it here. Now to connect the sky texture, we'll take this color socket and connect it to the color socket of the background. But we do not see any changes here. And that's because we have added a default Blender HDRI. And to disable it, click on this drop down arrow and turn on the scene world. And now we see this sky texture, or basically this environment, applied in our scene. And to adjust how it looks, we can change the parameters from here. The first thing that I'll do is to reduce its strength from here. So we'll reduce it to a lower value like 0.1. And now we can clearly see the sky texture around the 3D viewport. Suppose you want to change the size, rotation and position of sun. So you can try to change these values. If you want to increase the intensity, you can go to the sun intensity value and try to increase it. Right now I have set it to very high value, that's why it appearing like this. But if I reduce it to its default value of 1, it would appear like this. Similarly, you can go to the sun elevation option and try to change the angle of sun from the horizon. Also, you can rotate the sun with the help of the sun rotation option. Basically, this will impact the shadows in your scene and the lighting of different objects. Then you have this option of altitude, which will define the position of the source of light, which is the sun, from the sea level, which means the base. So if I increase it to a very high value, then the altitude of sun will increase. Similarly, if you want to change the color of this environment, you can go to these values of air, dust and ozone. If I take the air value and increase it, the environment will get more of yellow or orange look. But if I reduce it to its default value and try to increase the dust, then it appears like this. And if I change it to 1 and try to change the ozone value, this will change the environment or the sky to blue color. But there are some specific parameters that you can use if you want a perfect environment for your scene. For example, we'll set the sun size to 5. Sun intensity will be set to the default value of 1. Now we'll set the sun elevation to somewhere around 100 degrees, sun rotation to 90 degrees, and we'll set the altitude to a value of around 5000 to 6000 meters. And now we have a blue sky background or the environment in our scene. We'll set the air and the dust values to the default 1 and ozone to a value of 10. And now we have a perfect sky texture applied to the background. So whenever you want a sky texture as the environment, you can simply add the sky texture with this world selected as the shader type, set these parameters and connect it to the background, set the strength to 0.1, and you will end up making this simple looking sky texture. And this brings us to the end of this chapter, and also to the part of materials, textures and nodes, because from the next chapter, we'll be starting with another exciting topic of Blender, which is scene lighting and cameras. But before that, we need to do one more thing. Actually, in the chapter number 21 of this course, we made this layout as the default layout of Blender to work on the shaders and materials part. But now this layout is no longer required as the default layout. And to get back the older layout, which is the default Blender's layout, you have to go to the file option here, then select the defaults, and here you have the option of the load factory settings. So I'll select this load factory settings, click again to confirm, and here we have the default Blender layout. Now if I again go to the file option here, in the defaults, we have this save startup file. So we'll select this and click on the confirmation. So from now on, whenever I'll open Blender, this default Blender layout would appear and not the one that we created for the purpose of understanding shading in Blender. And yes, the next chapter will be the chapter number 25, scene lighting and cameras. So don't forget to subscribe to our channel, press that notification bell so that you can get timely updates about the upcoming chapters. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.